Language, the Basics, Second Edition, by R.L. Trask, read by John Telfer. To the listener, this book is not a textbook. It makes no attempt at comprehensive coverage, and it contains no exercises. Instead, it aims only to get you thinking about one of the most important and fascinating topics you could ever hope to encounter: human language. Nothing is more important to us than language, and I hope this little book will quickly persuade you that nothing is more interesting, more stimulating, or more rewarding than the study of language. I have chosen 9 very different aspects of the study of language, and under each heading I present and discuss a representative sample of the work which has been done and which is being done now. You will discover that you know a great deal more about the grammar of English than you ever suspected. But you may also be surprised to find that you can't explain the meaning of the word dog. You will learn about the astonishing way in which young children go about the business of learning their first language, about the startling effects on language of genetic defects and brain damage, and about people for whom words have colours. Perhaps you already know that the remote ancestor of English was spoken in Russia, but are you aware that English is changing fairly rapidly at this very moment, and that we can see it changing if we know how to watch? By the time you've finished this book, you will know something about the mother-in-law languages of Australia, about the amazing gender systems of Navajo, Swahili, and Gerbo, about the strange arrangements the Norwegians have made for their language, and about why plumbers sound different from lawyers. You'll learn the truth about those Eskimo words for snow, and you'll find out why a universal translator is impossible. You'll learn how we can express meanings that aren't actually there, find out why some questions are impossible to ask in English, and find out how the harmless little word nurse can wreck a social occasion. Some of the work I discuss was done decades ago, but most of it has been done only very recently, sometimes so recently that you will hardly be able to find an account of it elsewhere. I hope you enjoy listening to this book as much as I've enjoyed writing it. Chapter 1. The Uniqueness of Human Language. If you were asked to name the trait which most decisively distinguishes human beings from all other creatures on the planet, what would you choose? Love? Warfare? Art and music? Technology? Perhaps. But most people who have considered this question at length have come up with a single answer: language. As I shall try to demonstrate, human language is arguably the single most remarkable characteristic that we have, the one that most truly sets our species apart. Our faculty of language, which we usually take for granted, exhibits a number of properties which are remarkable, even astonishing. Without language, we could hardly have created the human world we know. Our development of everything from music to warfare could never have come about in the absence of language. More than any other single characteristic, then, language is what makes us human. And human language is unique. At first glance, this uniqueness may be far from obvious. After all, nearly every creature on the planet seems to have some kind of signaling system, some way of communicating with other members of the same species, and occasionally even with members of other species. Crickets chirp, birds sing, monkeys squawk, fireflies flash, and even ants leave smelly trails for their co-workers to follow. And no doubt you are convinced that Rover or Tiddles has a special sort of woof or meow that means, I'm hungry, or I want to go out. Moreover, recent work by ethologists, people who study animal behaviour, has revealed that many animal signalling systems are far more interesting than was once thought. You may be aware, for example, that certain species of whales are now known to sing songs, or that honeybees perform elaborate dances to announce the location of nectar to the hive. Fascinating as these discoveries are, however, and however much they may remind us not to take our fellow creatures for granted, the fact is that human language is so utterly different from all these other signalling systems that we are obliged to treat it as a thing apart, a truly unique phenomenon. In this book, I shall try to explain some of the fascinating and astonishing things we have discovered about language. I begin with some of the fundamental properties which are often collectively known as the design features of language. One of these design features is absolutely crucial to the very existence of language. Duality of patterning. For most people, most of the time, the ordinary medium of language is speech. How do we speak? Easy. We allow air from the lungs to pass out through our mouths, and at the same time, we move our mouths in various ways to produce speech sounds, consonants, and vowels. Every utterance we make consists of a sequence of speech sounds, one after the other. But here's an interesting question. How many different speech sounds can you produce? Different enough, that is, that the person you're talking to will have no trouble in telling them apart. Well, there is no cut-and-dried answer to this question. It depends on just how much difference you want to insist on. But the number is certainly not large. Unless you've had specialist training in phonetics, the study of speech sounds, you will probably find it very difficult to produce even 100 different individual sounds. Remember, we're talking about individual sounds here, not sequences of sounds. In fact, every human language operates with a much smaller set of speech sounds than this. Let's take a look at English. Consider the word cat. How many speech sounds does it contain? Well, the English spelling system is not very trustworthy on questions like this, but here the spelling does suggest the right answer. Three. They are the k sound, the flat a, and the t sound. These distinctive speech sounds are called the phonemes of the language. Now, if someone asks you what the English word k-a-t means, you will have no trouble in answering. But suppose someone asks you instead what the English phoneme k means. This time it is impossible to answer, for the phoneme k, or k, in fact, has no meaning in English. Nor does any other phoneme. A and t are just as meaningless as k. But now notice something else. These same meaningless phonemes can be rearranged to produce different words with different meanings. Thus, the order t-a-k produces the word tack, while a-k-t gives act, at gives at, t-a-k-t gives tact, or tact spelt t-a-c-k-e-d. Note that tact and tact, t-a-c-k-e-d, in spite of their different spellings and different structures, are pronounced identically by most speakers of English. Let's add one more phoneme to our set, the p sound. Now we can form the word p-a-t, pat, as well as t-a-p, tap, p-a-k, pack, k-a-p, cap, p-a-k-t, packed, or packed, p-a-c-k-e-d. T-a-p-t, tapped, t-a-p-p-e-d. Apt, apt. K-a-p-t, capped, c-a-p-p-e-d. And quite a few others. You can see what's going on. By combining a very small set of meaningless speech sounds in various ways, we can produce a very large number of different meaningful items. Words. All human languages are constructed in this way, and this type of structure is called duality of patterning, or duality for short. Duality is the use of a small number of meaningless elements in combination to produce a large number of meaningful elements. Why is this type of structure so significant? Well, just imagine what the alternative would be. Suppose we had no meaningless sound units to work with. Suppose instead that every individual sound we could produce had its own meaning. What would be the consequence of such an arrangement? It's obvious. The number of different meanings we could express would be no greater than the number of different sounds we could produce. And since we have already seen that we can't produce more than about 100 different speech sounds, the result would be that a language could only contain about 100 words. And this would be catastrophic. Imagine an English consisting of no more than 100 words. It is not remotely possible that, with such a drastically limited vocabulary, we could do most of the things we do with English. We couldn't explain to the mechanic what's wrong with our car. We couldn't tell our children stories about rabbits or elves. We couldn't organize elections or negotiate treaties. We couldn't charm our way into another person's heart with seductive conversation. And we certainly couldn't write books about language. So what? You may be asking at this stage. Why am I making such a song and dance about duality? Isn't it the obvious way to go about things? Maybe so. But here's the crux. No other species on Earth has a signaling system based on duality. Duality is unique to human language. In fact, bird songs and whale songs arguably contain an element of duality, but these are not exactly signaling systems. What do other creatures do, then? They do what we have just declared unthinkable for human language. Their signaling systems are based on the principle of one sound, one meaning. That is, a typical non-human animal will have one sound, meaning perhaps, "This is my territory," and another meaning, "Look out, danger in the air," and perhaps a few more. But that's it. The total number of different things such a creature can say is no larger than the number of different sounds available. In practice, the number of different signals, or calls, used by any given species is usually between 3 and 6, though vervet monkeys have the remarkable total of 20 or so. And this, it should be obvious by now, is a stupendous difference. Some of the other important characteristics of language that we will be discussing are only made possible by this fundamental property of duality. Incidentally, perhaps you are wondering just how many phonemes there are in English altogether. The answer, 40-odd. Why such a vague answer? Because not all English speakers use exactly the same set of speech sounds. For example, do you pronounce the words buck and book differently or identically? People who pronounce them differently have one more vowel than those who pronounce them identically. What about hair and air? People who pronounce these differently have one more consonant than those who pronounce them identically. The same goes for cot and court, three and free, pull and pool, fur and fair, and poor and poor. Similarly, people for whom singer and finger do not rhyme have one more consonant than those for whom they do rhyme. You may be a little surprised to learn that some people make a distinction you don't make, or fail to make one you do make, but that's the way things are. However, very few English speakers have fewer than about 40 phonemes, or more than about 45. Other languages differ in the number of phonemes they use. At one extreme, the Brazilian language Piraja has only 10, 7 consonants and 3 vowels, while at the other, some languages of Africa have over 100, most of them consonants. The average number seems to be around 25, so that English with its 40-odd is a little above average. But regardless of the number of speech sounds used, every human language is built on the principle of duality of patterning, a principle which is absolutely unique to us in the natural world, and a principle without which language as we know it could not exist. Displacement and open-endedness. Displacement is the use of language to talk about things other than the here and now. We have not the slightest difficulty in talking about last night's football game, or our own childhood, or the behavior of dinosaurs which lived over 100 million years ago, or the ultimate fate of the universe. With equal ease, we can discuss political events in Peru, or the surface of the planet Neptune. Open-endedness is our ability to use language to say anything at all, including lots of things we've never said or heard before. Here are a few English sentences. 1. I find that polythene banjo strings give a most unsatisfactory twang. 2. Luxembourg has invaded New Zealand. 3. A large pink spider wearing sunglasses and wielding a feather duster boogied across the floor. 4. Shakespeare wrote his plays in Swahili, and they were translated into English by his African bodyguards. It is most unlikely that you have ever encountered any of these sentences before, and yet you have not the slightest difficulty in understanding them, even if you don't believe all of them. Nor do you have any more difficulty in producing totally new English sentences whenever you need them. In fact, most of the things you say and hear every day are completely new to you and may never before have been uttered by anyone. Both of these phenomena, our ability to talk about places and things far away in space and time, and our ability to produce and understand new utterances virtually without limit, are so familiar to us that we never give them a moment's thought. And yet, they are truly remarkable. Remarkable and absolutely vital. Can you imagine being able to talk about nothing but the present moment and about nothing but what you can see as you speak? Equally, can you imagine speaking a language that consisted only of a fixed list of possible utterances, so that every time you opened your mouth, you could do no more than choose one utterance from that list? Such a language would be inconceivably far away from what we understand languages to be. And yet, this unthinkable state of affairs is exactly the way animal signaling systems appear to be. With one striking and famous exception, discussed later, non-human animals do not exhibit displacement. So far as we can tell, mice do not swap stories about their close encounters with cats. Nor do bears soberly discuss the severity of the coming winter. Rabbits do not engage in heated arguments about what might lie on the far side of the hill, nor do geese draw up plans for their next migration. Virtually all utterances by non-human animals appear to relate directly and exclusively to the time and place of uttering. Furthermore, these creatures exhibit nothing we could call open-endedness. Instead, it appears to be genuinely the case that each species' signaling system contains only a small number of possible utterances, and that nothing can be expressed beyond the limited range of possibilities available. A monkey might be able to say, "Look out, eagle," if that message is available in the system, but that same monkey cannot introduce any novelties. He cannot, for example, come up with an unprecedented, "Look out, two hunters with rifles," or, still less, on spotting his first Land Rover, "Hey, everybody, what do you suppose that is?" Of course, given the absence of duality, it could hardly be otherwise. We have already seen that duality is essential in a system that can express more than a small number of different meanings. Lacking duality, non-human creatures appear to be locked into a world of expression which we can barely conceive of. a system of communication lacking both a past and a future, bounded by the horizon and devoid of novelties, consisting only of the endless repetition of a few familiar messages about what's going on at the moment. There is, however, one striking exception to this bleak picture. We know of one creature whose signaling system conspicuously exhibits displacement, apparently uniquely in the non-human world. What is this remarkable creature? Not the chimpanzee, or the dolphin, as you might have guessed. It's the common honeybee. In the 1950s and 1960s, the Austrian ethologist Karl von Frisch carried out a series of studies which revealed something unexpected about the behavior of European honeybees. When a honeybee scout discovers a useful source of nectar, it flies back to its hive and then performs an astonishing little dance inside, watched by the other bees. The details of the dance vary depending both on the distance to the nectar and on the particular species and variety of bee. Honeybees have dialects. In the most famous case, though, the dancing bee performs a tail-wagging dance in the form of a squashed figure eight with a straight middle section. Von Frisch was able to decode this dance as follows. The time the dancing bee takes to complete a circuit of the figure eight indicates the distance to the nectar source. A longer time represents a longer flight. The level of excitement demonstrated by the bee represents the quantity of nectar, and hence the number of bees needed to harvest it. Greater excitement, more nectar, and hence more bees needed. Finally, and most stunningly, the orientation of the straight part of the figure eight represents the direction of the source with respect to the position of the sun. For example, if the straight section is oriented at 80 degrees to the left of straight up, the bees will fly toward a point 80 degrees to the left of the sun. Now, this is displacement. The dancing bee is passing on information about a nectar source which it visited some time ago, which is now perhaps miles away, and which it therefore cannot see. Moreover, the watching bees clearly understand that they are being informed about a task which they should perform in the near future. And the system is extremely effective. Von Frisch found that his bees could regularly locate nectar sources up to about 7 miles away, about 11 kilometers. This is impressive. How successful do you think you'd be at finding a particular cluster of bushes 7 miles away after being given only oral directions? Wonderful as the bee dance is, it is nonetheless, as von Frisch was able to show, severely limited in important respects. In a famous experiment, he allowed some scouts to find an artificial nectar source, a bowl of sugar and water, placed on top of a pole 20 feet high, much higher than the bees were accustomed to finding nectar. The scouts returned to the hive and danced as usual. The result? A swarm of bees soon arrived at the pole, buzzed around it in seeming confusion for a while, and then went home. The dancing scouts had been utterly unable to include in their dance the novel bit of information about the height. Or, as von Frisch put it, there is no word in honeybee for up. The honeybee dance is astounding, and we are forced to admit that at least one creature besides human beings can exhibit displacement in communication. But we must not let our amazement obscure some hard facts. The honeybee dance is unique in the animal world. No other creature has anything similar, not even other insects. And that dance is severely restricted in its communicative power. It cannot cope with the slightest novelty. Apart from its undoubted displacement, The bee dance is just as limited in its expressive power as any other animal signaling system. Bees have nothing that we would recognize as language. Stimulus freedom. Related to some of the preceding design features, but nonetheless partially distinct, is the property of stimulus freedom, which is the ability to say anything you like in any context. Suppose someone says to you, "What do you think of my skirt?" You are free to make any response you like, including none at all. You might reply, "It's too short," or "It doesn't go with your pink blouse," or "Sorry, I have no taste in clothes." You can even decline to answer and change the subject. Of course, this doesn't mean that human conversation is utterly random. There are all sorts of social pressures that make some responses more likely than others. If you value the friendship of the woman in the skirt, you are most unlikely to reply, "God, Julia, my dog's blanket would look better. You have the worst taste in clothes in the Northern Hemisphere." Even if you're thinking that, you probably wouldn't say it. But you could say it if you wanted to. There's nothing about English that prevents you, but merely social conventions and the desire to maintain good relationships. The absence of stimulus freedom would once again reduce human language to something unrecognizable. Just try to imagine a world in which your every remark was completely determined by the context, so that, like a character in a play, you never had the slightest choice of what to say. There are, of course, certain formal and especially ceremonial contexts in which something like this actually does happen. Church services, Passover meals, the taking of oaths. But such contexts are not the norm. And even there you could, in principle, say something unexpected, if at the cost of ruining your position in society. By now you are probably expecting to hear that stimulus freedom too is unique to human language, and I shall not disappoint you. Non-human signals are not stimulus-free, but rather stimulus-bound. That is, a non-human creature produces a particular signal always and only when the appropriate stimulus is present. If Fred the monkey is up a tree and he sees a dangerous eagle approaching, he automatically produces the cry that means, "Look out, eagle!" And he never does this at any other time. He doesn't, on spotting the eagle, think to himself, "Maybe if I keep quiet, the eagle will grab old Charlie down there and I'll be safe." Nor does a bored Fred suddenly come out with an eagle warning and then guffaw, "Ha ha, Charlie, got you that time." Very occasionally, however, an animal has been observed to do something unusual. For example, an Arctic fox was once spotted making a danger call in the absence of any danger, apparently just to distract her cubs from a meal she was trying to eat. But such incidents are, so far at least, very rare and strictly anecdotal. They do not represent normal behavior, which is overwhelmingly stimulus-bound. Lacking duality, lacking displacement, lacking open-endedness, lacking stimulus freedom, animal signaling systems are almost unfathomably different from human languages. The communicative world in which other creatures live is as different from ours as anything we could imagine. From our point of view, bleak, featureless, closed in on every side. As I said at the beginning of this chapter, human language is unique on Earth, and without it, we could not count ourselves human at all. Arbitrariness. In addition to the design features which set human language well apart from animal signaling systems, there are others which are not unique at all, but nonetheless worthy of attention. Chief among these is arbitrariness, which is the absence of any necessary connection between a linguistic form and its meaning. Note that word necessary. I am certainly not suggesting that there is no connection at all between the English word pig and the large snouted animal to which we commonly apply it. Of course there's a connection, but it's an arbitrary connection. There is no a priori reason why English speakers should apply the particular sound sequence pig to that particular animal. The connection is purely a matter of agreement, and the word can be successfully used only so long as English speakers agree to use it in this particular way. Speakers of other languages, of course, have reached different agreements. But no word is intrinsically better suited to naming this particular animal than any other, though each is perfectly adequate as long as speakers agree about it. Such agreement need not be for all time. The animal was formerly called a swine in English, but this older word is now little used, except as a light-hearted insult, and pig has replaced it as the name of the animal. The decision as to which words shall have which meanings is entirely a matter of convention. Different languages have different conventions. That's part of the reason they are different languages. And conventions can and do change. Arbitrariness can be demonstrated the other way round. The English word mean has several different meanings. Or, more accurately, there are several different English words sharing the form mean. The French word mine, spelt M-I-N-E, sounds almost exactly like English mean, spelt M-E-A-N, but the French word means coal mine. Likewise, Welsh min, spelt M-I-N, means edge. Basque min, M-I-N, means pain, and Arabic min, M-I-N, means from. There is nothing about this sequence of sounds that makes any one meaning more natural than another. The overwhelming presence of arbitrariness in language is the chief reason it takes so long to learn the vocabulary of a foreign language. It's generally impossible to guess the meaning of an unfamiliar word, and each new word just has to be learned individually. Even if I give you the big clue that all of the following Basque words are the names of living creatures, I very much doubt that you'll be able to guess any of them. Saldi, Igel, Churi, Ulyo, Bey, Sagu. In fact, they mean horse, frog, bird, hen, cow, and mouse, respectively. This arbitrariness is the reason that the universal translator, beloved of science fiction B-movies, is simply impossible. You know the scene. Our intrepid space adventurers arrive on a new planet and find an alien race speaking a totally unfamiliar language. So they whip out their machine and twiddle a couple of dials and, hey, presto, the alien speech is at once rendered into perfect American English. Because of arbitrariness, even the most powerful computer can have no way of knowing whether the alien utterance Kwafnyi means welcome to our planet, or prepare to be sacrificed to the great god Quaff, or you've parked your spaceship in a tow-away zone, or perhaps even, hey, Edna, come and have a look at these weirdos. On a more realistic scale, even if you learn a couple of thousand Basque words, if someone says to you, watch out, you might run into a lupu out there, where lupu is a word you don't know. You have no way of knowing whether a lupu might be a bear trap, a poisonous snake, an armed robber, or a starving wolf. In fact, it's a scorpion, though in a now extinct dialect of Basque. Recorded in the 16th century, an identical word, lupu, meant wolf. So much for the universal translator. Arbitrariness is in no way unique to human language. It is typical of animal signaling systems and of virtually every conceivable system of communication. But occasionally, in language and elsewhere, we find elements which are not entirely arbitrary, but rather somewhat iconic. Iconicity is a direct correlation between form and meaning. We saw some iconic elements in the bee dance, in which a time represents a time and an angle represents an angle. But English, too, has some iconic elements. The most familiar examples of iconicity in English are provided by instances of onomatopoeia, the representation of sounds by words of similar sound, such words as splash, clink, buzz, meow, moan, whoosh, thud, moo, ping, quack, and boom, all represent attempts to reproduce real-world sounds with English phonemes. But even these onomatopoeic items still exhibit a great deal of arbitrariness in their forms. The easiest way to see this is to compare onomatopoeic items from several languages. The sound of a gunshot is represented in English as bang, in Spanish as boom, in French as pom, in German as ping, and in Basque as wurst. In fact, onomatopoeic words are so strongly arbitrary that they have to be learned individually, just like ordinary words. Can you guess the meaning of Japanese chirin chirin? It means tinkle. How about Turkish ship? It means plop. Turkish shuk? It means clap or crack. Hebrew yimyum? It's meow. Basque kukuruku. Easy, this one. It's cock-a-doodle-doo. Japanese pew. It's whiz. There is another, much more subtle type of iconicity in language. Suppose I tell you that the Basque word chimileta is also the name of a creature. What sort of creature do you suppose a chimileta might be? Large or small? Fast or slow? Pretty or ugly? Any thoughts? Now, suppose I tell you further that chimileta means one of the following: fox, bull, butterfly, snail, tortoise. Which do you suppose it is? Well, I was hoping you'd guessed it by now. Most people find that the word chimileta seems to suggest not something large or ponderous or slow, but rather something small and light and fluttery. And so they correctly pick out the only small, light, fluttery creature in the list. This is not onomatopoeia, because the form of the word chimileta is not in any way related to the sound of anything. Butterflies don't even make any sound. Rather, the sound of the word seems somehow to correlate with the appearance of the insect. The word sounds light and fluttery, and the butterfly looks light and fluttery. This type of iconicity is sometimes called phonesthesia, and both phonesthesia and onomatopoeia are varieties of what is more generally called sound symbolism. All types of sound symbolism are partial exceptions to the more usual arbitrariness of language, but sound symbolism is a special case, and arbitrariness is the norm. The vocal tract. As I mentioned earlier, the primary medium of language is speech, that is, the production of sequences of speech sounds. Speech is performed by allowing air from the lungs to pass up and out through the mouth and nose. Of course, speech is not the only possible medium for language. If you were reading this book, you'd be aware that language can be transferred with a high degree of success into the medium of writing, though this transfer is a recent development in the history of human language. The oldest known written texts are less than 6,000 years old, while speech, as we shall see later, is very considerably older than that. And even now, the great majority of the world's 6,000 or so languages are not normally written down. Of uncertain antiquity is the invention of sign language, in which language is transferred to the medium of gestures made chiefly with the hands. This, too, we shall be discussing later. But speech is the primary medium, and human beings have evolved in such a way as to make efficient speech possible. The passageway through which air flows as we speak is called the vocal tract, and the human vocal tract is highly unusual, even unique among mammals. Even our closest relatives, the apes, have vocal tracts which are quite different from ours, and which are not very different from the vocal tracts of, say, horses or mice. There are several significant differences. For one thing, the human vocal tract is much larger and differently shaped. It extends well down behind the back of the tongue. Further, there is a big difference in the connection between the trachea, or windpipe, which leads through a complex structure called the larynx to the lungs, and the esophagus, or gullet, which leads to the stomach. In the chimp, as in most mammals, a large cartilage called the epiglottis serves as a kind of valve between the two. When the epiglottis is raised, the trachea is connected to the nose and the mouth is sealed off. When the epiglottis is lowered, the mouth is connected to the esophagus and the trachea is sealed off. This useful arrangement makes it virtually impossible for a chimp to choke on its food. The human being, however, is not so fortunate. The long part of the vocal tract, called the pharynx, is common to both the flow of air and the passage of food, and the small human epiglottis is not very effective at sealing off the trachea during swallowing. As a result, it is very easy for us to choke on our food, and dozens of people die this way every year in Britain alone. Why have human beings, almost uniquely among mammals, evolved this dangerous arrangement? Why have we not retained the safer vocal tract of our ancestors? Even more intriguing is the fact that newborn human babies have vocal tracts which resemble that of the chimpanzee, and young babies are therefore protected against choking to death. Only after about 3 months does the infant's growth begin to stretch its vocal tract into the dangerous adult shape. It looks as if evolution has really worked very hard at rearranging our vocal tract into its present curious shape. But why? Dangerous or not, the human vocal tract has one great advantage. Since it is so large and elongated, it allows us to produce a number of speech sounds, at least some dozens of distinct consonants and vowels, as you'll recall. But the chimpanzee vocal tract and the vocal tract of a newborn baby lack this ability. Investigation has shown that the chimp vocal tract can scarcely produce more than one vowel and a couple of consonants, and this is not nearly enough to allow speech and language. Recall that we need to have a range of speech sounds at our disposal in order to take advantage of the fundamental design feature of duality. No speech sounds, no duality, and no duality, no language. Many investigators have therefore reached the conclusion that our vocal tracts have evolved very specifically to allow us to speak. The idea is that speech and language proved to be so beneficial to the species that we became specialized for it even at the cost of losing a number of our fellows to death by choking every year. Intimately related to the evolution of our distinctive vocal tracts would have been the accompanying evolution of our remarkably big brain. The use of language requires not only the ability to speak, but also a very considerable capacity for rapid mental processing. And apes, we now know, also lack that part of the brain which performs the mental processing required for speaking. There are several landmarks in the history of human evolution. Our upright posture, for which we have paid the price of frequent problems with our backs, and our hands, with our skillful fingers and especially our opposable thumbs, were of course vital developments. But these, as we now know, were evolved millions of years ago by ancestors who had not yet acquired large brains and probably not our distinctive vocal tract. More than any other development in our history, the development of speech and language set us apart from our ancestors and from our relatives, and put us, for better or for worse, on the path to our uniquely human behavior. Indeed, several specialists have suggested that rather than calling our species in Latin Homo sapiens, the wise human, we might better call ourselves Homo loquens, the speaking human. And just when did human language evolve? No one knows. Almost everyone agrees that language has been around for at least 100,000 years or so, which is when we find the first evidence of fully modern humans indistinguishable from ourselves. A minority of scholars would suggest a much earlier origin, going back perhaps to our immediate ancestor, Homo erectus, over a million years ago. The topic is controversial, of course, since we have practically nothing in the way of evidence. One famous attempt at tackling the question has been made by the speech scientists Philip Lieberman and Edmund Krelin in a series of publications. Their work concerns the Neanderthals, a somewhat distinctive, stockily built people who inhabited Western Europe until around 35,000 years ago, when they abruptly vanished, possibly under pressure from our own direct ancestors. Working with a fossilized Neanderthal skull, Lieberman and Krelin have proposed a reconstruction of the Neanderthal vocal tract, and their reconstruction shows a vocal tract very different from ours, and more akin to that of a chimpanzee. Lieberman and Krelin therefore conclude that the Neanderthals could not have produced an adequate range of speech sounds, and hence could not have spoken. Fascinating though this attempt is, Lieberman and Krelin's conclusions have been fiercely attacked on various grounds. For one thing, the crushed skull they used has been improperly reassembled by an earlier worker. For another, it appears that several different reconstructions are possible even after the skull is restored to its proper shape, including some which look much more like modern human vocal tracts, and some critics have argued that Lieberman and Krelin's reconstruction would not even have allowed the owner of the skull to open his mouth. The question, therefore, remains open. We do not know when language appeared, though most specialists would guess a date much less than a million years ago. Language without speech. Sign language. For most people, the primary medium of language is speech. But speech is not the only possible primary medium, and it is not even the only one that human beings use. Deaf people cannot hear sounds, and so speech is not a very convenient medium for them. But most deaf people have normal vision, and a visual medium would be quite suitable for language in their case. And such a medium exists. It is called signing, and a language whose primary medium is signing is a sign language. Let me first clarify this term a little. A true sign language is not just a way of converting a spoken language into signs, though such systems exist, nor is it a crude auxiliary system of the you Tarzan, me Jane variety. Instead, a true sign language is a genuine human language, complete with a large vocabulary and a rich and complex system of grammar. A true sign language can convey anything that can be expressed in a spoken language, and it even allows its users to make jokes and puns and to use obscenities. A true sign language is the mother tongue of a sizable number of people, most of whom are deaf. In short, there is absolutely no difference that we can see between a spoken language and a sign language, except for the medium. The signs of a sign language are gestures made primarily with the hands, face, and head, but sometimes also involving the arms, shoulders, chest, and other parts of the body. At present, there are some dozens of sign languages in use in various parts of the world. In Britain, the most prominent sign language is British Sign Language, or BSL. In the USA, the counterpart is American Sign Language, or ASL. BSL and ASL are completely unrelated to each other, and British and American signers cannot understand each other any better than speakers of English and Hungarian. Moreover, neither BSL nor ASL has the slightest connection with English, and neither even resembles English. Indeed, Both BSL and ASL have grammatical structures which are utterly different from that of English, but rather similar to the grammatical systems of certain North American languages like Hopi and Navajo. Though BSL and ASL are not related to these languages either. So far as we know, BSL and ASL arose among the deaf communities in their respective countries in the late 18th and 19th centuries. A version of BSL was carried to Australia, where it developed into Australian Sign Language, or Auslan. BSL and Auslan have since developed rather differently.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.